brother. What's up?
This is a good party, man.
Yeah, brother,
I dig it.
Stop. Right on.
I think anyone who puckers up their lips and presses it against their boss's buttocks and then smooches is an ass kisser.
I seem to be inept at everything except my work. I'm good at my work. So I confine myself to that. All I want out of life is a 30 share and a 20 rating.
The man's enlarged my mind. He's a poet, warrior in the classic sense. I'm a little man. He's a great man.
Think of it as colors. There's black and there's white. And in between is mostly gray. That's us. Now, gray is a tough color because it's not as simple as black and white. And for the media, certainly not as interesting. But it's who we are.
What a game this was. You exploded in that third quarter. What were you seeing out there?
Just a bunch of mismatches. Yeah, pretty much.
This is the yin and the yang of it. Leader Fan Radio Network.
I don't know.
And KFAN.com. 1 minute. 46 seconds past the hour, 3 o'clock Central Daylight Time. Welcome back. It is a midweek edition of the Bumper to Bumper program on a beautiful Wednesday afternoon here in the Twin Cities of Minneapolis and St. Paul. I host the program, former Inkstained Ratch newspaper, the Twin Cities, the Sultan of Snark. My name is Dan Barrero. I am the chief bloviator on this program. Not very alliterative, but you get the point. Gardzi's the producer, two-time state high school tennis champion, and, of course, the radio voice of the Golden Gopher women's basketball team, not to mention sideline reporter on Golden Gopher football games. Unfortunately, he will not be able to do any sideline reporting, I don't think, at the spring game because that has gone away. Much to the anger of several emailers overnight that I got. I don't know. I'm sure you're getting some. I'm getting a bunch of it.
I've heard from a few people.
We might revisit that story later, but I don't know if we're going to have time to because we got a lot of good stuff on the agenda to get to probably first. And this show is all about priorities. Bradshaw and Brian Caffey and text line should be your priority. 64686 if you would like to join the conversation and be a part of it and even attempt to perhaps get me going. We'll give you details on the Borton Volvo guest lineup in just a couple of minutes because it has a new name today. One that is, I don't believe he has ever been on our program previously, but I'm very much looking forward to that. The other is a, we like to call it, in-studio Wednesday regular. Last night was one of those nights for the Minnesota Timberwolves as far as my viewing experience. I was quite curious to see if we could rebound after the loss to the Los Angeles Lakers of Anaheim. And it sure looked to me fairly quickly that the answer was going to be a resounding no. And as the Wolves were falling further and further behind, as they were clanking shot after shot off the rim, Jaden McDaniels literally looked like a guy who didn't. He almost looked Rudy Gobert-like on the wing. I'm thinking to myself, we're going to be lucky to even get home court advantage in the first round. We're going to start plummeting so far.
Yeah.
I mean, we're going to make the playoffs, and we're not going to be back in the play-in. I didn't think we could fall that far, but I'm thinking there's a good chance we're going to be the 5 seed. Maybe even the 6 seed. This looks hideous. This looks awful. Conley was missing shots again early. We were turning the ball over. People were driving on Rudy Gobert like he wasn't even there. And for the game to go from that being my honest view, in fact, I think what I tweeted out was the obvious. We miss Cat, and we still need a sniper. Yet somehow, some way, the Wolves turned around the night to such a degree that by the end of the ball game, I'm saying we could still get the number one seed. Why not us?
Yeah.
Why not?
We've got enough.
We just separated ourselves from the Clippers. We won the season series, a key game with them. We gain it. You know, it's like worth two games because the Clippers wanted to gain and basically come up even with us. And now I'm thinking, what do we have to worry about? The Allen Horton stats were brilliant after the game. Before last night, over the last 13 seasons when trailing by 20 or more points, the Wolves had a record of 3-186. That's a winning percentage of .015.
Sorry, KFAN.
It was our best comeback in, what was it, 15 years? The 2010? Was that the 2009? I don't remember, but it's been actually 2002. The largest comeback since November 5, 2012, I should say. So you do the math on that. That's 12 years. I can even do that math. And it wasn't simply that, these comebacks, you can come back from 22 down in the league. It's hard, but it's doable. But the fact that the Wolves outscored the Clippers 83-39 over 27 minutes.
Minnesota!
To go from 22 down to 22 up, that's what made it absurd and made me go from, we're done, first round exit, we might get swept, and no home ice advantage even the round one, to...
Believe.
Let's keep fighting for that number one overall. Well, we can't catch the Celtics realistically, but number one in the West. Why can't we do it? A couple other teams above us, including Oklahoma City, they're starting to maybe look a little bit vulnerable. And how we did it, I don't know that this is sustainable, the model. But for one night, final score 118-100, it was very effective and very entertaining. Down 22 with 5 minutes, 13 seconds to play in the second quarter. So what the hell changed? Well, slumping point guard Mike Conley, regular guest on the Bumper to Bumper show, found his shot to the point where it was almost like, and Conley's not really wired this way, you could almost hear him say, give me the ball. Anthony, out of the way. I'm taking another three. As in Ant, Anthony Edwards. Meanwhile, your guy, Naw, did he miss a shot last night?
He missed one.
He missed one shot.
9 for 10.
He was absurd. And he made it easy to forget that, you know, Jaden McDaniels was having difficulty hitting shots.
And good defense from Naw, per usual.
Always good defense from him. Rudy started doing what they call in the business Rudy things. Apparently motivated prodded by the head coach, who said, Rudy, you remember who you're supposed to be? You're not supposed to be the guy who gets fined $100,000 and complains about the refs. You're supposed to be the guy that clogs the middle.
And
he
didn't punch him like he did with Slo-Mo last year.
That's true.
He took the criticism.
He did. He accepted it.
He took the coaching and said, okay, I got you, Finchie.
And then there was Anthony Edwards, who had left Reggie Miller on the national broadcast open-mouthed, to the point where you could almost hear the drool coming out of his mouth.
George now, guarded by Edwards.
Look at this. This is what I like about it. Edwards,
moving his feet. George can't get Miller. Forces a turnover. Edwards drives and lays it in. You're seeing Anthony Edwards in all of his glory right there on both ends.
Love it.
This young man is what they call a doll.
Misses. Edwards wants to push. Wolves, their biggest lead has been two. That's it. Edwards puts him up four. Anthony Edwards, the Georgia Bulldog.
There it is. Brilliantly played, perfectly timed by Guardsy. And I'm glad he got the seminal soundbite at the start of the show. How classic Ant is it? What'd you see in the court, and what do you usually get? Well, you know, I just... saw, you know, I thought I had some opportunities. I thought I had to make some things happen. What does Ant say? A whole bunch of mismatches.
That's pretty much it.
And what he was acknowledging there was that's post the injury to the guy who was guarding him some of the time.
Kawhi Leonard. He did say that after.
Did change. Now, Kawhi was not great. I think Kawhi only had 6 points in the first half. And the Wolves had started to make it interesting. I think they were down 8 at the half. So they had, if they don't make it that close, there is no comeback. Bottom line is, Edwards, so honest, was 100% right. And you know what I loved about him last night again? He took the mid-range. Mid-range should not be illegal in a three-point dominated league. When you have his elevation on the jump shot, it's a good shot, man. It's an effective shot, and he used it last night. Again, apparently prodded, according to Ant, by his head coach, who clearly was on his A-game, coming off whatever illness he had a couple of days before that. Post-game studio, Shaquille, he's always been a dog. I'm not surprised.
Got that for later.
It was, honestly, I was, and it's interesting because our 3:30 guest, I was listening to him for a while this morning, he had some of the same sort of yin and yang throughout that game as he's watching it. It was hard. I'll put it this way. I was extremely gobsmacked that that level of reversal took place in that ballgame. I just didn't think there was any sign. They looked beaten. They looked like they were hanging their heads, and they looked like, God, we got a problem. And I, by the way, I still think they need a sniper. I still do. Unless Gnaw is about to emerge into a sniper, I still think that's a problem that is going to end up haunting them that they have to address in this offseason. I wanted them to address it at the deadline, but how many real snipers are you going to get at the deadline that are going to be available? But an utter and about as complete a reversal within a single game as I can remember in recent Timberwolves history. And I know it left Clippers fans bitter and a little bit dazed, and it had to give... It's the kind of lift that I do think can carry them for a little while. Like, oh yeah, we reminded ourselves that even without Cat, we got some pieces. We can do some things if we play it right and, frankly, hit some shots, which, again, was really what catapulted them. Guys who haven't been hitting shots hit shots. So how much of that shot making can we depend on?
That's going to be the tale over the last 15 games.
There's no question about
it. And can Ant basically carry them for stretches like they need him to?
God, he was.
And he can, for different times.
He absolutely can, and he did, largely after, I think, a slow start, didn't he? Wasn't he off to a slow start, too?
I think everybody kind of was, yeah. And then he started to heat up, certainly in that third quarter.
Everybody seemed in a daze. And look, one thing is obvious. They can run more without Cat because Nas runs the floor better, right? He just moves better in the open court. Let's face it, Cat has ability driving to the basket, but he's a bit of a plotter in that regard. Nas is not. Nas is quite quick on his feet. And so that's another thing you do when your offense is stalling. Get out in front. Get ahead of him a couple times. Get some easy baskets that way as well, which obviously Anthony Edwards did. We'll come back with the Borton Volvo guest lineup. I want to get back to a little bit more Vikings conversation and controversies in our next segment, and then we'll prepare, as I said, for our 3:30 guest, I should say. Don't go away. Pat Kessler stops by in studio at about 5:30 this evening. Lots to get to on the political side with him. Kessie, 5:30. On the Borton Volvo guest lineup. Next segment, we'll be joined by Frank Isola, another former Inkstained Wretch turned over the dark side of broadcasting, now co-hosts NBA channel Sirius XM's Morning Show. And it's a great listen, as I've told him many times over the last several years. And we're thinking about an NBA guy today, and we said, well, let's maybe try to go in a little different direction. As it turns out, Isola and his pal Brian Scalabrini, had lots to say in reaction to the Wolves' victory last night. So we'll catch up with him at the bottom of the hour and get into some other largely National Basketball Association controversies as well. A couple people have asked me about By the way, I didn't know, realize that Edwards missed the start of the second half. Did you?
Yes.
I missed that. Yes. I must have, like, walked away or changed clothes. I don't know. So was there an explanation given for this one, or is it now just assumed that with him, you just never know? He just might just show up a little late from the locker room.
The way they talked about it, I don't know about anything after the game, but the way they talked about it the first couple minutes of the third quarter was, yeah, he came out here and then used that timeout to kind of get stretched out, was dribbling the ball around a little bit. So I don't know. He must just be, checking in with the kid a lot or something.
So we don't think it's incontinence?
No. That seems to be a popular theory.
They did advance that
a little bit.
People want to believe that because they almost would be willing to excuse that. It's something physical he can't control.
Right.
It's hard. It's more daunting to think, well, no, it's just a discipline issue where he just can't get out there. And obviously when he plays as well as he did last night, largely people are going to move past it and not particularly care. A couple of people asking for thoughts on Vice President A-Raj. Well, we did discuss this when the story broke yesterday in a decent amount of depth. And I was stunned to pick up, there's like a 10-page printout pages story at The Athletic by Zach Rosenblatt under the headline, "Can Aaron Rodgers run for US VP and play for the Jets? Key questions for quarterback and team."
I'm glad somebody took a dive at it.
So isn't the question rhetorical? Put it this way, if you're running the Jets, no matter how patriotic you may like to think yourself to be, how can you possibly tolerate this question even being asked? Now, again, he's not going to win. Obviously, RFK Jr. might screw up the election for Joe Biden, but he's not going to win. Okay, so it's not about, well, what happens once they win? It's, well, the election's in early November, isn't it?
Usually.
So keep campaigning time, even if you're going to get routed. You're going to go through the motions, right? RFK is going to go through the motions. Is the 6 weeks especially running up to it? So how in the hell, how can this even be? Because the stories are almost written like, well, let's see, could you put this together with this? And we'd miss, because actually in the offseason, a lot of the offseason stuff isn't required anyway.
That's right.
And so they're going piece by piece of this thing like they think, well, there might be a way.
I kind of like it.
There is no way.
As a guy who has a lot of jobs, there's always a way. There's always a way to figure it out. It takes some flexibility. It takes a lot of people giving.
I'll say this. If I'm running the Jets and I've listened to him harangue us about what we got to do, and we got to do this, and we got to get rid of this guy, and this is the season where we've got to get a lot more serious about everything we do, I'd roll my eyes and say, are we paying you or not? Period. End of story. I found the quote. Everybody's seen it. Remember the A-Raj quote on the way out the door at the end of the 2023 season? Anything in this building that we're doing that has nothing to do with winning needs to be assessed. Everything that we do has to have a purpose. The bull bleep that has nothing to do with winning has to get out of the building.
Oh, that might That might come back to haunt him.
My God.
Yeah.
I mean, and at the time, I think a lot of people were aroused and go, oh, you know what? He means business. He's serious about this stuff. New sheriff in town. And so, what are you talking about here? So that's my reaction. The whole thing is, it was another, I think, stating the obvious. This is in an ESPN.com story. Obviously, life on the campaign trail would pose a major conflict for Rodgers, who said in a recent interview that he hopes to play 2 or 3 or 4 more years in the National Football League. Honest to God. Sometimes, even by A-Rod standards, the degree to which he's capable of taking himself seriously, like very few other people in that business that we know, is downright breathtaking. And this might be another one of those times. Kirk Cousins did what most of us predicted he would do, because number 8 loves to play it always. He sent out a heartfelt video looking directly into the camera, thanking Minnesota Vikings fans, thanking the Vikings, thanking his coaches, thanking former ex-players, teammates, everybody, about how bittersweet this sort of thing is. And I'm not a Kirk Obo, but I'm here to tell you, if I were like you, I'd throw up. I know it's the his way of, you know, he's trying to be classy, trying to salute on the way out the door that he hasn't forgotten you just because he took the money and ran.
180 mil.
I wouldn't want to hear. I don't care. If I'm a Corcobo, I don't care. It means nothing to me. In a football sense, you're dead to me. Not in a real life sense, but in a football sense, you're dead to me. No matter what your intent is, and no matter what a nice guy you still might be, I want nothing of it. It would be better, cleaner, if you just walk away. Once you made the decision to walk away, don't try to have it both ways. Or is it too much to say, to ask him to look into the camera and say, boys and girls, I know I've mouthed a lot of platitudes.
Did you see the guarantees?
Exactly. And say, I know people don't like to talk about it, but in the end, it was just too good of a deal for me to pass up. And end it right there. Just end it right there. Because do you think the Corcobos are idiots? Does he think it's a cult? Because I don't think it's a cult.
No, it's not.
It really isn't.
We liked it because he was our guy. He was he came out of his shell under our watch with us, taking the shirt off, doing the chains. We all liked it. I'll tell you this, Dan, as president of Cousins Condos, I watched that video. I have the sound. We might play it later.
Okay.
I felt nothing for my guy, Kirk
Cousins.
I don't
blame you.
Nothing.
Yeah,
and, I just
it's not even hatred. It's just nothing.
I feel nothing. And you have no legacy.
You got to do, or we're moving on. You know, that's it.
As you said, your legacy is Mr. March.
That's it.
The legacy you are leaving in this game, which you said is important to you, your legacy is taking the biggest paycheck everywhere. And that doesn't mean you're a bad person.
No.
It doesn't mean you're weird. It just means you're not what you told us that you were. So we're good.
By the way, chances better of Jesse being his running mate, being RFK Jr.'s running mate, than A-Raj, don't you think?
Probably, because Jesse doesn't have to take snaps during the National Football League season while you're running a campaign. Just on that basis alone.
But that's the arrogance
more
of A-Raj.
Available.
A-Raj needs to say, thank you. I'm flattered.
This is great.
But I can't possibly do that. They're paying me a lot of money. I've made it sound like we've got to get more serious about everything we do. And then I'm gonna continue to play this touchy-feely game about running for VP.
How about this, though?
God, what chutzpah.
Chess move, though. I think Pelissero talked about it on NFL Network today. The owner of the Jets, I think, was part of Donald Trump's cabinet.
That's true.
So that could be, and like you say, if he jumps in with RFK and blows it for Biden and President Trump gets back in there, then maybe Jets guy doesn't care about Super Bowls because he's got his guy back in the White House. Maybe this is sucking up to his new boss in a way that we didn't think.
Let's get the national perspective from the outside looking in at the NBA and particularly the Timberwolves after a remarkable historic come-from-behind victory last night. Frank Isola is next. Man. Our next guest defines Inkstained Wretch, turned over to the dark side. ESPN's Around the Horn, PTI, and of course the co-host of the starting lineup every weekday morning on Sirius XM NBA channel as well. Frank Isola, kind enough now to join us via the Connecticut Water Systems Hotline. We welcome you to the show, and I appreciate you joining on short notice. I always fear someone with your schedule. I'm going, well, he might be pinch hitting on PTI today. He might be around the horn. I mean, how do you keep up with, how do you keep up with your schedule?
You know, it sounds obnoxious, but you used to make fun of people that had like a personal assistant.
Yeah.
I can't afford one, but I could see why people would get one. I'm actually I'm doing the Nets game tonight. I do their games on the Yes Network. So they play tonight in Orlando. So I go to a studio, and I'll do when they're home, we're in Brooklyn. But when they're in studio, it's in Stamford, Connecticut. That's where the Yes Network is. That's where the Yankees do this stuff. But I like how you mentioned the newspaper. Let me ask you this. Do you miss, I know you're a legend now.
Of course.
In the radio world, you miss working for newspapers, though.
Not as much every once in a while, but not, I've gotten, I think, lazy enough and far enough away from it that I don't miss it as much as I thought. But I think part of that is because I really like what I'm doing. And clearly you like what you're doing.
Yeah, I do. I miss the newspaper a little bit. I always feel like, I don't know if other people take you more seriously when you write for a newspaper.
Yeah.
Maybe you take yourself more seriously when you work. Hey, the radio stuff is fun. And I think it helped, you know, being having a background in newsprint, I'm sure you know this.
Yep.
You know, you kind of know how to develop a story.
Yep.
You can kind of see through the nonsense. Plus, you know kind of how the sausage is made, so to speak, because you did see everything kind of behind the scenes. So it kind of it helps you. You know, I think we probably come at it, you and I, from a different angle than some other people who didn't work for newspaper. As you know, Dan, you know, you mentioned PTI, you know, Michael Wilbon, Tony Kornheiser were newspaper people. Even Stephen A. Smith was a newspaper person, Adrian Wojnarowski, Adam Schefter. You know, a lot of people who made the transition started out in newspaper.
100%. Well, what's fascinating to me, and what I've always been amused by, if I go back, I don't know how many decades this would be, there was a time, as you know, when the notion of making this sort of transition was so incredibly and completely looked down upon by newspaper bosses. I mean, I felt like in the beginning of my radio days, I almost had to apologize for even doing it. And what are you doing? Why would you even mess with that? It's not real like what we do. It's not substantive like what we do. And now, of course, all bets are off. It's now, in fact, we've gone from, well, don't ever mention that you're on the radio, to we're going to, at the bottom of your column, we're going to put a little piece of information that explains when you're on the radio and so forth. And I'm sure you've seen that too, where it went from this sort of you're a black sheep. What are you doing? To now it's okay and it's cool to do.
And I think it was in to some ways looked down upon. I think people worried about how objective you would be and how can you still remain objective. But I think that's the fun part about being on radio. I mean, when you write for a newspaper, you just try to tell the truth. And listen, we have people that we like that we cover, but you try to be as honest as you can be. And in the NBA, the NBA is an interesting one because a lot of polarizing players. Like, I'm critical a lot of LeBron, but I also acknowledge how incredible the guy is. And when he plays well, which is most of the time, we praise him. When he says some of the silly things he says, like he doesn't like being praised, I mean, give me a break. We have a little bit of fun with that.
Yes, you do.
So I still think just trying to be as honest as you could possibly be without taking cheap shots. Now, there is, I watch a lot of the Premier League and I listen to the broadcasters over in England. Their whole thing is fair, critical analysis all the time. Like, and here's the other thing too. They go after the best players. I try to do the same thing too. I'm not going to sit around and like take cheap shots at some role player. You know, if the best players are responsible, get all the money and they get all the praise when they win, well, when the team loses, you have to, you know, let them hear a lot of the criticism. And I think sometimes, I think our sporting culture, we tend to blame everybody else a lot of times except for the star players.
Yeah, that's a very fair point. And, part of it, I think, is it's another example of where the industry has changed. And I think there was early years before there was this constant transition from newspapers to radio and TV. It was jealousy. I'll be honest. It was, you'd hear from other sports writers and they would want to look down on the whole enterprise because they didn't get a gig or they really deep down kind of wanted it. And you and I both know, by the way, there's a lot of crappy radio. There's a lot of, shows that I'm sure you would want to associate with that I wouldn't want to put my name on as well. That is really surfacey and cheap and kind of stupid. But the notion that that was all the medium was capable of. Both mediums. That's what bugged me, and that's what bothered me about a lot of other sports writers back in the day who were like, that should be beneath you. I'm not going to even mess with that. And those generalizations about dismissing pretty much the entire industry.
No, I think there's a lot of truth to that, but then, the economics of it. But I also think a lot of these, obviously the people that have hired you are smart. You, again, because you have kind of this experience, there's nothing wrong with it. You don't have to be in the newspaper business to do talk radio. It's only sports. But me, and I'm not saying there's anything wrong with it, I'm not really into the hot take type of thing. If other people want to do it and people enjoy it, that's fine. I have no problem with that. I know that's part of the business. And you know how it is, too. We're doing morning radio, so it's a little bit more lighthearted. I'm lucky, too, because I do with Brian Scalabrine, the former NBA player, who's a broadcaster for the Celtics. I mean, is he wearing Shamrock underwear? Certainly. He wants to see the Celtics do well, mostly because it's going to benefit him financially. And the dude, like, still has the first dollar that he ever made. But, he's kind of at that stage of his life where he's far enough away from the NBA where he kind of looks at everything somewhat in a cynical way. Not everything, but I think that's what makes him a good radio partner. But to your point, though, I mean, you still try to remain as objective as you can. But I would say this, being in the news, my first job, besides covering high school basketball in New York, which was a pretty good experience. You know, I got thrown onto the Met beat really early in my career, and a guy named Joe Sexton, who worked at the New York Times, and he went on to work in the Metro section. He was part of a bunch of teams that won the Pulitzer Prize for some, you know, pretty good coverage, like the TWA flight that went down in the Long Island Sound, or that I should say, you know, Long Island Sound. But he had told me something I still remember this day when I was young. He said, if somebody's not mad at you, you're not doing a good job. And that doesn't mean, again, that you're not, that you're taking cheap shots. But if you're telling the truth, and especially when you cover losing teams, and the Met team that I covered lost 103 games. The Knicks, after Jeff Van Gundy left, they basically had 20 years of losing. So most of the stories were somewhat critical. What else do you want me to write? And, you know, and I always remember, I always felt like people were mad at me. I always felt that was probably a good thing in the long run. Now I realize it's my wife and kids that are always mad at me, so maybe it's not a great thing.
Well, we're chatting with Frank Isola. You know, in my, and I want to get to your impressions of the Wolves here in a minute, but this is kind of nicely off the beaten track, I think, in that, you know, back in the day when I was still writing, one of the baseball players I had a great relationship with was Frank Viola. And what was interesting about Sweet Music was he didn't love, like, when those of us who were writing columns would rip the team, but he kind of understood it. And he and I talked about that a few times. And he said, well, part of the reason I understand it is I come from New York. And I understand that obviously there I'm used to writers who are going to come on pretty strong and they're going to challenge teams and they're not going to be afraid to do that. And that was like foreign, I think, to a lot of the players, a lot of the other players who were part from other parts of the country. But it was interesting to hear from even an athlete who kind of seemed to get it. And he said, the reason I get it is that's what I grew up with. That was the kind of coverage that I kind of was aware of regarding, you know, the New York newspapers, New York media.
You know, it's funny. I was actually around the Mets. I would fill in every once in a while. I actually went on road trips, and he was on the Mets, Frank Viola.
Yep.
The players on the Mets would bust his chops like it was nobody's business. Now in New York, I got, you know, the first time on the Knick beat, I'm covering Patrick Ewing. So, you know, Patrick Ewing was a guy that when the Knicks lost, it was always his fault. When they won, well, yeah, Patrick played well, but he's supposed to play well. And hey, knucklehead, how come you could never lead us to the championship? And Patrick was unbelievable, kind of existing in that world where he got criticized. He, you know, he somewhat understood. Sometimes he would go, he would ask you about something you wrote, but he would never be nasty. He would never try to intimidate you. He kind of got it.
Right.
And I always really respected him because even toward the tail end of his career, the fans were starting to, even though he was playing less minutes and taking less shots, he was still getting blamed for everything. So he was making the sacrifices that everybody wanted to make, yet he was still getting a majority of the blame. And watching the way that he handled it, that to me, it was eye-opening. But it was also interesting, I think, you know, after Patrick left, and I think about the Knicks, how much losing they did, and I kept thinking, boy, I bet you people really appreciate Patrick
Ewing. Sure.
Now, because at least when he was here, they were a contending team and they won a lot.
Yeah, very good point. So you're watching, I listened some this morning, you're watching the Wolves game last night, and I think It was your reaction was pretty much the same as mine that I talked about at the top of the show. As they're falling down by 22, I'm going, you know what? They're going to slide not only out of the top playoff spot, they may not even have home court advantage once we get to the end of the season, to by the end of the damn game with that ridiculous historic reversal for them. I'm going, why not us? Why not now? So tell me what you saw last night. And maybe more generally, what your impressions have been, because it's nice to hear from people who aren't stuck in the middle of it, where sometimes you can't see the forest for the trees.
Yeah, and you know, obviously what the team is a very good defensive team that has a guy that has a chance to be a really special player in Anthony Edwards. You know, they play. I did a game back in studio when the Nets were there on a, I think it was a Sunday night, if I'm not mistaken, or maybe it was a Saturday night. And they were playing a back-to-back. They, you know, they had played Milwaukee. I'm talking about Minnesota played Milwaukee the night before. And you can tell the play, like, that was going to be a tough game for them. And then the game was closed up until, like, the last 8 minutes. And all of a sudden, Anthony Edwards played like he was shot out of a cannon. And I was like, man, this guy, like, he just has a special quality about him. But I think, number one, the coach, Chris Finch, has done a great job. So everything is based around defense. There's a lot of accountability with this team. So even though they've lost Carl Anthony Towns, which is going to hurt them offensively, it still hasn't hurt them defensively. It's going to be tough because the Western Conference is so darn good. So, you know, I could still see them losing some games here,
sure,
but like,
yep.
yesterday, like winning a game like last night, and I get it, you know, Kawhi went out. But when you're down 22 and you basically have a 40-point turnaround in a game on the road, it tells you that you're a serious team. What I love about Chris Finch, he's like, well, in today's NBA, it's a little bit, you come back like that with a 3-point shot. And I love the way that he, the position that he took after Towns had the great, what was it, the 60, whatever point yes, game that he right. had. And they lost that game to Shaw. I happened to be watching that game. I could tell early in the fourth quarter, I was like, they're going to lose this game mm-hmm. with the way that they're playing. And the way that Chris Finch handled that afterwards, I thought that set a really good message to the team. It set the right tone. I think around the NBA, I know for people in Minnesota, you know, maybe sometimes when you're too close to it, you don't recognize it. But people around the NBA take the Minnesota Timberwolves seriously from like the front office, from the coaching staff and the players that they have. And I love Anthony Edwards. There's something, it's weird. There's kind of a redeeming quality about like his innocence. And I think he's funny a lot of times without trying to be funny. Like I'm trying to always be funny, so I don't always pull it off. I think Anthony Edwards, he just like some of the things that come out of his mouth, like in a, when he's being playful about it, are actually pretty funny.
Well, did you hear, by the way, speaking of playful, what he said immediately after the game with the Bally Sports Network broadcaster. Was it Bally?
TNT.
No, TNT. What am I talking about? It was a TNT game, not Bally. Do you have it, Garzy?
What a game this was. You exploded in that third quarter. What were you seeing out there?
Just a bunch of mismatches. Yeah, pretty much.
I mean, that's to your point. It's so earned. Yeah, a bunch of mismatches, and he was right. That's what it was once Kawhi went out.
Yeah. And, you know, I've said this, you know, I did PTI last week with Michael Wilbon, and one of the topics we did was the block shot that he had against the Indiana Pacers. And I was surprised, you know, Michael Wilbon knows Jordan really well. And I was actually surprised that he made a comparison on some level to Michael Jordan. But I thought the same thing when I saw him play in person this year in Brooklyn. I don't know, maybe it's because the wristband on his, the way he wears it on his arm, but the way his body movement is on the court and the way that he gets his baskets, there is kind of, I'm not saying he's Michael Jordan, but there is kind of a Jordan-like quality about him. And the guy, what I like about him, he never seems to get rattled whatsoever. He's got a fire in him, which is something that you're going to need. He's got a chance to be a big star. And I hope he stays in Minnesota for a long time. Obviously, you know, Kevin Garnett had a great run there, but he won his championship. Yep. Someplace else. It'd be great to see if Anthony Edwards could do that, especially now. Let's think about it. You know, if you're the Minnesota Timberwolves and you're a Timberwolves fan, just look at some of the recent champions. Giannis was drafted by Milwaukee, won a title there. Nikola Jokic, drafted by Denver, won a title there. They didn't need to go, you know, join, you know, five other guys in some, you know, cockamamie market to try to win a championship.
Did you have any, or do you have any concerns that occasionally Anthony tends to, you know, head towards the Luka line? When I say Luka, I don't mean like he complains, and nobody complains as much as Luka, but no. He's up to 12 technicals. He's sort of taken the mantle from Kat. That was one of the big raps on Kat last year. Kat's gotten a little better at it, and Ant has gotten much more animated with the refs. Do you have any concern about that, or the fact that, you know, occasionally he doesn't show up for the start of the game, or last night he didn't show up for the start of the third quarter?
Yeah, that's a great call. And I thought the same thing when that net game that they played at Brooklyn, he was really good in the first half. He started struggling in the second half, and I thought he spent way too much time arguing with the referee. Yeah. But you know what, though? That's a league-wide problem.
It is.
And it used to be, you know this, Dan, you know, the referees used to take the criticism or, you know, the complaining from the head coach, then they would take it from, like, the top two players. Now it's everybody. You know, if Joey Crawford today was reffing in the NBA, the first thing he would say is, who are you talking to me like that? And that would be a technical foul. But it is something, I think the league has let the players get away with too much of it. I think Anthony Edwards, you got to be careful going down that road. But it's funny you mentioned that about Luka, because I got to see Caitlin Clark play in person a month ago in College Park. And I was telling everybody, she got like a little Jason Kidd in her, like her passing.
Yep.
Steph Curry with the step back shooting. And I said, she complains like Luka Doncic too, because she works the rest a lot as well.
No question. There's no question about that. What did you make of the Rudy gambling, the fine, which was obviously considerable, $100,000? I thought he might actually get suspended. What was your, I didn't hear you guys that day. What was your reaction to what Rudy did and then what the league did to punish him?
And you know this. You know, you go down this road when you start, you know, questioning the integrity of the referees and of the league, it's going to be a big thing. And remember, too, you know, Scott Foster, who, if you ask most of the players and coaches around the league, they're going to say that he's the best official. You ask the other referees, they're going to say that he's the best referee. So it was meant towards Scott Foster. I think it was Natalie Sago, the other referee who saw him make the money symbol. But, you know, in light of the Tim Donaghy scandal, it's when a player is talking like that, the league is going to take notice. I think Rudy Gobert has got to be careful with something like that. It's not the league got all these leagues got in business and bet, I should say, with these gambling companies. So a lot of this stuff is always going to come up. But when a player does that, listen, Rudy Gobert would have been better doing what Draymond Green did. He would have been better choking somebody than, you know, questioning the integrity of the league.
Yeah, sad but true. In regards to this team's playoff capabilities, you know how the league is set up. Usually it's an up-and-coming team has got to make several runs. Maybe they win a series one year, they win two series another year, they fall back, and then they make a big run. They have that experience. The Wolves, as you know, have not won a playoff series since Kevin Garnett left, and that was just that one year. So do you view it open enough in the conference that you take them seriously as a team that, especially if obviously Cat comes back reasonably healthy, that can indeed make a run, even though that's not usually the pattern, the approach to success, the way this league has been set up?
Yeah, and I was at that series. I was at the Western Conference Finals when they played the Lakers that year with Garnett. Sprewell had a couple of big games, I think, in that series. I think they can. A lot will depend on Karl Anthony Towns if he does come back, because you know he's so important to everything they do offensively. But I think they have a chance. You know, you do have experience with Mike Connolly, which is going to help. Though it's going to depend on what matchups they get. They're obviously not going to have to beat everyone to get to a finals, but if they make it to a conference finals, they're going to play two really good teams in the first and the second round. It won't be easy, but I think they have what you need. They're strong defensively, and they got a guy that could be a closer that could take over a game at any point. So I think those two factors, and they're well coached, I think that'll help them. I look at the Western Conference, it's so up in the air. I mean, come on, you could be the number one seed, and it'll probably be Denver, I still think, at this point. Mm-hmm. Denver could end up playing the Golden State Warriors or the Lakers in the first round. I think they'll beat them, but that's tough if you're going to play LeBron James in the first round.
Let's finish up with a couple things about the show and the development of your show. And I think one of the areas in which you guys have separated yourselves is it's an NBA channel, I get that, and it's largely that's what you talk about, it's the NBA. But I think you've crossed over culturally a little bit into a place where you can come at comedy, you can have some fun with some stuff, and you've created organically these characters, these callers, such as West Side Mike is one of the great examples of this. Can you give us his history and your own feeling about how this approach developed? Did it just kind of happen? Was it planned? Because I do think that's what separates your show apart from, we're going to analyze, you know, was Isaiah Thomas, was he right when he called out, you know, the Golden State Warriors that without the Durant help, their legacy was gone? You do that stuff, but I think you get into some other things culturally that makes it feel more like a talk show, not necessarily just an NBA show.
Yeah, no, I appreciate that. I think that's what we try to do. West Side Mike is a character. He's a guy who's, you know, just about to turn. He's in his late 50s. He's from Alabama, so when he was growing up, the only NBA games that he saw, he said, involved the Celtics. So he became a Celtic fan. He lives in Chicago now. He's got in these incredible outfits that he wears, and he really knows the game. He calls us.
He does.
All the time. We're definitely going to do a show from his house. We have to eventually get there. But it's like, you know, it's little things that, you know, knowing sometimes who our audience is, like even, the world of basketball, it's so closely related to a lot of the entertainment stuff. So even talking about the Super Bowl a week before, and I said, all I asked was, is Usher big enough to carry this? Is he a big enough name for the Super Bowl? Does he have mass appeal? I think that's what I said. And we got so many calls on that, and everyone's opinion is fine. I mean, I kept saying, well, Prince, he's not Prince, he's not this person, he's not that person. And that got a lot of people stirred up. I mean, even the stuff with Chris Rock at the Oscars, when that happened, we talked about that. And I got to be honest with you, the women's college basketball stuff at times, like Monday's show, I was actually more interested in the South Carolina LSU kind of scuffle with the one player's brother jumping onto the court. You know, so we do try to go after, to me, basketball is the one sport where high school to the pros, they're all pretty connected. you know, like this guy, that, you know, this guy Cooper Flagg that's going to Duke, who reclassified as a high school senior, Brian's worked the guy for a couple of years. Mm-hmm. And the guy, that he's already projected to be the number one pick in the draft next year. So we've been talking about this kid for 2 years. So think about that. The kid's not even in college yet. We've talked about him a lot. He's already projected to be, I mean, he's a top recruit and could be in the NBA by you know, the summer of 2025. So we do try to, we don't really just base it on just talking basketball. To me, sometimes that can get a little boring. You try to look for like the hot topics that are out there. And usually the NBA players all having these, podcasts help because they I think unknowingly provide a lot of good content.
Yeah, you've definitely gotten good fodder out of who's the I'm terrible with names. The guy that all
Gilbert Arenas.
Gilbert Arenas is like it's almost I'm beginning to think on Gilbert Arenas that he's just doing his podcast for you.
It's been great because he keeps criticizing all the European players. Which yes. I think after a while, like I think it's becoming a shtick, but it's all there is also something a little uncomfortable about it. When you start calling, like, you know, some of those guys soft, are you calling Giannis soft?
Yeah.
Nikola Jokic is soft. I'm not, and how much more did, like, a lot of these guys have to prove before you finally accept the fact, hey, it's the best basketball league in the world, so why wouldn't you want the best players? The Premier League in England is the best soccer league in the world. That's where most of the best players want to go play. It's actually a good thing for the NBA.
Frank, I really appreciate the extended time. It's good to catch up and continued great success. And hopefully we can maybe stay in touch as this thing, you know, develops as we get into the postseason. It'd be fun.
Definitely, Dan. Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
Thanks, my man. You as well. Frank Isola, longtime Inkstain Wretch, both New York tabloids, by the way. These days, Around the Horn, PTI, Sirius XM, NBA as well. I enjoyed that conversation. Hope you did as well. Top of the hour pause. Don't forget, Kessler is coming up at usual time in studio 5.